ओम ज्ञान तिमिरति ज्ञानांजन शलाकाय चक्षुरोन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः. हरे कृष्ण. सो टुडे वी कंटिन्यू आवर डिस्कशन ऑन द सिक्स लिम्स ऑफ सरेंडर एंड टुडे आई विल फोकस ऑन द थीम ऑफ moving forward from the two conceptions. In the first session, I talked about how surrender can be compared to healing, how the relationship between the doctor and a patient is similar to a relationship between Krishna and his and us. And while surrendering, yesterday I talked about anukulya, accepting the favorable and avoiding the unfavorable. Within that, I talked about primarily that when we are driving, say we need a map, and then we need to drive according to the map. So for both of these, we have to, scripture is like the map, and the application of scripture is the driving. So in scripture also, we need to focus on what is favorable and avoid what is unfavorable. That means if certain things don't make sense and they're not central to the message of the scripture, then we don't have to focus on them. And similarly, if certain things, say in the association of devotees, we find certain things are not according to the way we feel they should be, we don't get worked up by that, knowing that such things are inevitable in the material world. We talked about seeing the association and seeing the Krishna conscious movement at four levels: in ignorance, passion, goodness, and transcendence. So now beyond that, I'll today talk about how do we look at Krishna and how do we look at ourselves in a way that enables us to move forward in our devotion. So our actions are shaped by our conceptions, not just conceptions, also our dispositions. So I talked about instincts and impulses, which comprise our disposition at a subconscious level, and also our conscious contemplation and decision-making. So in terms of the conceptions that we have or that we can have, if we consider that there are three, we can have certain conceptions of God and we can have certain conceptions of ourselves. And based on those conceptions, we will decide whether we'll be able to work properly or not. Say, for example, going back to the medical metaphor, depending on how much confidence we have in the doctor's capacity to heal us and to cure us, and depending on how much faith we have in our own curability. Sometimes some people get some cancer, and even if it is curable, they are so frightened by the word cancer that they stop taking any treatment thereafter, or they take it half-heartedly. They become pessimistic, thinking, I'm going to die now. Then, so that they have to have, they need, the conception of the doctor and the treatment is important, and conception towards oneself is also important. So I'll talk this in terms of, so rakshishyati iti vishwaso goktrutve varanam tatha. In these two, I'll talk about what our conception toward Krishna is to be. And then we will talk in tomorrow's session, I'll talk about Atma Nikshep and Karpanye, where I'll talk about how or what should be our disposition toward ourselves so that we can wholeheartedly practice bhakti. So Rakshishyati Vishwaso Goktritve Varanam Tatha, that Krishna is my protector. To have faith that Krishna will protect me. Avashya Rakshibe Krishna. Prabhupada would quote that in the context of the nectar of devotion, that Krishna will certainly protect me. And Goptrutve Varanam Tatha, that Krishna is my maintainer. But these two are two distinct concepts. Say, if we want to look at it from our perspective, we might say that, okay, we have security in our home, which is our protector. Security in our home, security around our home in the locality. We have security in terms of the police. We have security at the level of the border and the defense forces. So all this is security. And then security and maintenance are two different things. So for example, maintenance, for that, you know, we may have our job, we may have certain resources by which, say, the government maintains those who can't maintain themselves. So protection is more from danger. So protection is talked about when there is danger. Maintenance is for the normal survival. We could say that even normal survival is characterized by danger constantly. But still, there's a difference in the sense that normal survival, there in the normal course of our life, even if danger is possible at every moment, it's not that danger comes upon us at every moment. So basically, when we live in the world, soon we recognize that actually there is me and there is the rest of the world. So in the rest of the world, like yesterday I talked about, there is Adibhautik, Adidevik, Adhyatmik, our psychophysical, our social, and our environmental circles. And we could say all of this is ultimately under the control of Krishna. Maya adhyakshena prakriti suyate sacharacharam hetunanena kaunteya jagad viparivartate. So maya adhyakshena prakriti. Krishna says that material nature works under my supervision. Adhyakshata. Adhi aksha. Aksha is eyes. Adhi is from above. So adhyaksha is literally, it means one who sees from above, one who oversees or supervises. So oversee and supervision, both of them have the same idea of seeing and from above or a higher perspective. Suyate sacharacharam, and all the moving and non-living beings in this world. Hetunanena kaunteya. So by that cause, now what is that cause? It is Krishna's supervision, the world works according to its own order. Jagat viparivartate, going through constant change. So if we consider the constant change that happens in the world, it's almost a two-step causation Krishna is talking about. That when things happen in the world, Krishna says they happen under my supervision. But it is not just, there's a difference between supervision and intention. That means that, for example, a supervisor watches, if there's a factory and supervisor is watching how the workers are working. Now, everything that the workers are doing, the supervisor is not doing. And sometimes the workers may do something which is not right. And then when the supervisor sees, the supervisor may correct. Sometimes the supervisor may let a person make a mistake so that they learn from the mistake also. So here there's an important thing to understand, this difference between Krishna's supervision and Krishna's intention. Now, why is this difference important? Because if, say, as I said, that at a basic existential level, we can divide reality, the rest of reality. So if we are making that division, we and the rest of reality, then we may find that the rest of reality often works against us. And sometimes works very unfairly and brutally against us. And if this rest of reality we consider to be just one unit, that yes, the rest of reality is basically Krishna or God, and then if the rest of reality is hurting us in various ways, it might happen through various means. It might be some people might just get on our case and persecute us. Sometimes the weather might get on us. Some disease might just hound us relentlessly. So if we see the rest of reality as one unit, and that is targeting us, that is attacking us, then it will be very difficult for us to surrender to that rest of reality. Because, you know, I talked earlier about how the surrender is not like a defeated army general surrendering to the victorious army. It is more like a patient submitting to a doctor, and even more so, as we will discuss later, that it is more like a lover surrendering to the beloved. I will do your will. Now, your wish is my command, people say when they're in love with someone. So that is when Krishna and Arjuna says, Ashto mohasmate labdha tatra sadan mayachuta sitosmigata sandeha karishe vachinam tava. So karishe vachinam tava. After hearing the Bhagavad Gita in 1873, that's what Arjuna says. And here essentially he is meaning that your wish is my command. So when he is saying this, it's out of love. So it's not about, it's not so much out of fear or frustration. It's not about of disease and discomfort. It's out of love. So now for us, we may progress through all three phases in connecting with Krishna. Sometimes we may connect with Krishna at the level of fear. Oh, life is so much trouble. Krishna, please help me. Or it may be that, oh, the troubles in my life are because of my own misgivings and I need to purify myself of my impurities. So Krishna, please help me to purify myself. But the first is like a defeated military general. Second is like a patient going to a doctor. And third is, Krishna, whatever the situation in my life, however I may be, you are my Lord and I am your servant. I simply want to serve you. That it's out of love. So when we want to surrender to Krishna, we need to have a healthy conception of Krishna in relationship with us and in relationship with the rest of reality. Now, in some cases, say for example, when a doctor causes pain to a patient, the doctor's purpose is not to cause pain, it is to cure pain. So we know that at that particular point, the doctor is the source of the pain. That, okay, an injection is being given, a surgery is being done. But we could say the apparent cause of the pain is the cure for the actual pain. The apparent cause for the pain is the injection or the surgical instrument cutting into our body. But that is only the apparent cause. It is a cure for the actual cause of the pain. The actual cause of the pain is the disease, the disorder in the body. And that is cured by the doctor. So now in this case, in some cases, we understand that actually, this is the disease I have and this is the treatment for this. And as a part of the process of treatment, I'm going through this. So in this case, if we see reality in this way, that means in the rest of reality, I am going through some difficulties and I want to surrender. But it is the rest of reality that is causing me suffering. Now, is all of the rest of reality Krishna? Well, we could say ultimately everything is controlled by him. So it is in one sense non-different from him. So sometimes we can see that the pain that the rest of reality is causing us, that is ultimately for us to learn something. Say, somebody, we trust them and they betray us bitterly. That can shake our faith, not just in that person, and not just in humanity. Can people be like this? It can shake our faith in ourselves also. You know, am I such a bad reader of people that I couldn't discern that this person would do like this? And what does that say about my intelligence, my capacity to make decisions, trust, reliable, sound decisions? And it can be very, if we are betrayed, it can be very, very psychologically disorienting, depressing, even devastating. Now at that time, if we are to recover and move on, it's very difficult to see this as Krishna performing a surgery. Normally when some kind of surgery is happening, then we understand that okay, this is the disease, this is the process for the treatment, and this is how the treatment is happening. Many times when the suffering is going on in our life, if sometimes we may be fortunate enough to know what is it that is the disease and how what we are going through is a cure. So for example, when Bharat Maharaj became attached to a deer, and therefore in the next life he had to take birth as a deer, and then after that he took birth as Jad Bharat. So in that case, he was given the remembrance of what he had done wrong, and thus he was very cautious as a deer. And he didn't just frolic around like other deer, but he stayed near the sages and heard the sacred Vedic sounds from them. And next life, although he was born in the Brahmin family, he did not get involved in the ritualism. He focused on spirituality, and he was indifferent not only to rajas, but even to sattva, not only the passionate pleasures of the world, but even to the sattvic pleasure that might come by living a pious life. He was indifferent to that also, because he thought even that may entangle me. In the past, it was a sattvic virtue of kindness, of compassion, that had entrapped him. Of course, after it was then compassion that it was not exactly compassion that entrapped him. It was compassion that was uncritical, that was not carefully thought out. That compassion soon degenerated into passion. But the point was, it started with something sattva, apparently sattvic, saving the life of someone else, of a deer, baby deer, that. But then after that, he started thinking of it as the maintainer of that deer and became attached. So it from sattva, it went to rajas. So he was so careful that he decided that even something in goodness, I will not let myself get attracted by it. So here he knew, okay, what was his mistake and why did he have to take some extra births? But in most of our lives, we don't have that facility. The workings of karma are so complex that they can give even complex thinkers a complex. Complex means, you know, if you get an inferiority complex, if we are with someone who is super fast at doing something, we are struggling to recollect a verse, and they have also recollected, they are not only recollected and recited that verse, but the next verse also. If, say, some people are, they are fast at doing things. And if somebody is fast and somebody else they meet is really faster than them. Say, we just open our phone and somebody else has not only opened their phone, but has typed the message and sent the message also. Some people start getting a complex. You know, am I good for nothing here? How? If we are not used to being a slower person in the world, just being with somebody faster can give us a complex. So similarly, for those are complex thinkers, to not understand something, that can give them a complex. How can I not figure this out? But karma is gahana karmanogati, as Krishna says in 4:17. So the complex sentence that I said about complex, that the workings of karma are so complex that as to given complex thinkers a complex. That is just a wordplay, a retelling of the Gita 4:17. Anyway, the point is that in our lives, we can't so easily know what is the disease and what is the cure, or what is the disease and how what we are going through is a cure for that disease. We can pray, and sometimes the Dhammi Buddhi Yogam Tam, we get the understanding of that. We see with respect to Parikshit Maharaj, it was a minor mistake and a major reaction for that. Now, was it for some other past karma, or did he himself know that it was the Lord's plan? He did not get too caught in that. So for us to surrender to Krishna, all this might seem a little philosophical, but the point I'm making right now here is that when we are praying, say, and our prayers are not being answered, then how do we surrender? Normally, we may pray half-heartedly and we may work also. Sometimes we may stop working and just start praying. But if sometimes our prayers are not answered, then how do we surrender? How does this, if we may say, I have the faith that Krishna is my protector and Krishna is my maintainer. But what if the protection doesn't seem to be coming? What if my maintenance itself is under threat? So then how do we understand that Krishna is our protector? So the faith that we require in Krishna has to be philosophically grounded. It cannot just be based on naive realism. In bhakti, we take our perceptions seriously, but we don't take them literally. We take our perceptions seriously. What does it mean? That means what we see with our eyes, what we see with our ears, we take it seriously. For example, if you're going on a road, if there's a ditch, we need to step aside from it. We'll fall and get injured. Similarly, if there's something which is very attractive, depending on what it is, we may have to keep a distance from it, or we may go toward it. So our actions are very much shaped by our perceptions. So in that sense, we take our perceptions seriously, but we don't take them literally. Literally means we don't think that what our eyes show us is the complete reality. It is one part of the reality. So when we pray to Krishna and apparently there's no protection coming, how do we stay surrendered at that time? That surrender requires us to understand Krishna better, to understand how Krishna works and how Krishna is our well-wisher at a better level. So that means that the rest of reality when we see, so let's take this example now of Parikshit Maharaj continuing this. At one level, we could say Parikshit Maharaj surrendered to Krishna when he was cursed to die in 7 days. And he surrendered, he expressed his surrender by just determinedly hearing without getting distracted. And yet, what happened? At the end, suppose there's a movie which starts with a hero being cursed to die in 7 days. And then at the end of the movie, that hero dies. Hey, what's this? You know, I thought it was an adventure movie, but this is a disaster movie. I thought adventure means the hero will escape somehow mystically. But the hero doesn't escape. So the same Vishnu or Krishna who protected Parikshit in his mother's womb from the Brahmastra, was that Krishna not capable of protecting Parikshit from the curse of a Brahmin? Ashwatthama was also a Brahmin, and it was, you could say it was his weapon, which is also like a curse. Curses are also used. Kshatriyas use weapons and Brahmanas use curses. So in this case, Ashwatthama was a Brahmana who used a weapon. But Sringi was a Brahmana who used a curse. So the same Lord Vishnu who protected Parikshit in the mother's womb, why did he not, why could he or why did he not protect Parikshit at the when he was cursed? So Sringi's curse apparently had its effect. And Parikshit Maharaj died. So what's going on over here? Was he not protected? He was protected. The protection the Bhagavatam demonstrates is at the spiritual level. That his consciousness was protected. His consciousness, by his continuous determination to hear and by his having the facility of Shukadev Goswami being there ready to speak about Krishna Katha in such a beautiful way, heart-enriching way, that he became absorbed in hearing about Krishna. And it is not that Takshak destroyed Parikshit Maharaja, the snake bird killed him. Rather, it was that the Krishna Katha and the absorption coming from Krishna Katha delivered Parikshit Maharaj. His soul, he had entered into a trance and his soul left the body and went to Krishna Loka. And when Takshak came and bit him, it was just a body that was destroyed by Takshak. the soul had already become elevated and liberated. So sometimes Krishna's protection comes in a way that we can see at the material level, as happened to Parikshit at the start of his life. And sometimes the protection doesn't come in a way that we can see at a physical level. So if we consider protection and maintenance only in terms of what we see at the physical level, then our faith in Krishna will be shaky. And that's why surrender is not just, yes, Krishna, I'm surrendered to you, I have faith in you. But that faith also requires a philosophical understanding that reality is bigger than how we perceive it. And therefore, whatever is happening, it may seem a particular way to me, but there is more to it. There is more to it. So sometimes at the material level, things may be fixed by Krishna's mercy. And sometimes, by Krishna's mercy, even if things are not fixed, we become fixed in him. We become fixed in our devotion. And that is the ultimate fixing. Ultimately, no matter how well things are fixed in the world, they will break down. So sometimes things are fixed by Krishna's mercy. Sometimes they are not. If we consider Krishna's protection only in terms of things getting fixed, then we cannot stay surrendered for very long. So it's like a patient has pain and the doctor's treatment is ultimately meant to cure the pain. But sometimes, say in some forms of treatment, the doctor's treatment might increase the pain temporarily. And the patient needs to persevere through that. So this pain, which is induced after the treatment starts, is actually maybe cleansing the person of something which is going to cause much greater pain. Like say somebody has some digestive problems. And then they go and do something like panchakarma. And panchakarma, they have something like virechan. They give you pills and the whole all the bowels are emptied by that. And that can be quite exhausting and stressing and disturbing experience. You say, actually, I came to this place to be healed. And here, what's happening to me? My body seems to have become worse. But if we understand the overall purpose of the treatment, specifically which pill will react how to which patient, that entirely can't be predicted by doctors. But they can direct the overall direction of the therapy, and over time things will heal and things will improve. So similarly for us, when we are practicing bhakti, Krishna's protection is not necessarily in terms of our immediate material well-being. It is, Krishna also cares for our immediate material well-being, no doubt. But Krishna's, if the immediate material well-being, if securing that will require losing our ultimate spiritual well-being, then Krishna may sometimes take that away. So we need to have the philosophical vision to see that even when things are going wrong, ultimately, Krishna will bring good even out of the bad. That means that now, how do we see this? That sometimes something very bad happens to us. Now, if we are surrendered, does that mean that we see the bad itself as good? So now, all that I have spoken, I will talk about this in three distinct ways. Basically, how can we stay surrendered when we are having distress and despite our devotion, the distress doesn't seem to be going away? So there are three distinct visions. One is that Krishna, one vision is to see that Krishna is the cause of this distress. The other is that Krishna is the shield from this distress. Shield me, the distress is coming, but Krishna can shield me from it. The distress may stay, but Krishna will shield me from the distress. And the third is that Krishna So is the cure of the distress. Now in the second and third conception, the shield and the cure. A shield is not itself a cure. Shield means it is there still, but I am protected from it. Cure is, okay, it is countered. Krishna is the ultimate cure of the distress. So now all these three visions of Krishna are fine. Let me talk about some examples to illustrate these points. Say, for example, now, when we talk about Krishna as the, if we consider Krishna as the cause of our distress, then we may wonder, why is Krishna causing the distress? Maybe Krishna has some particular purpose, but if we don't see the purpose, then we might start thinking that, you know, is God cruel? Does God even care for me? If God does something like this, why should we surrender to him? Why should I surrender to him? Why should I worship him at all? So it's difficult to have this vision of Krishna, that Krishna is causing our distress. Now, let's we may say Krishna is the cause of all causes. Yes, but he is not the, he's not the, there is a sanctioning cause and there is an intending cause. Let me give an example to illustrate this. That when Dushyasan was trying to disrobe Draupadi, now, is it Krishna doing that to Draupadi? Is it that Krishna in the heart is telling Dushyasan that do this to Draupadi? And do we expect Draupadi to see that it is actually Krishna who is doing this to me through Dushyasan? Obviously not. When Sita is being abducted by Ravan, is she going to think that actually Ravan is sent by Ram and it is Ram who is abducting me? Is Krishna literally the cause of all causes? Not literally. So when something happens in this world, there can be three levels of causes for it. There is God. This is a whole different subject. Maybe in future I'll talk about this separately, but it is for our context. See, there is God's will, there is free will, and there is evil. I repeat, God's will, free will, and evil. God's will is ultimate. It is the sanctioning authority. Without God's will, nothing will happen. So God's will is, like you could say, the circumference within which somebody can do something. Like a children are given a park in which to play. So the parents or their caregivers keep them in the park. But within the park, if two children start fighting and beating each other, and they go get a broken nose and a bleeding eye, then is that caused by the parents or the caregivers? No. That's why we see Bhutanam Yanmitha Kali. The Bhagavatam says in the Kunti's prayers that in this world, the problems, the conflicts are caused because of animosity among people. You, O Lord, are not the cause of the conflicts. So there is God's will sets the broad parameters within which human will acts. And say, within the, it sets the parameters, like the parents, they set the parameters within which children can play. So we all have free will, and based on the kind of karma we may have done in the past, we are given certain level of influence around us, certain level of capacity to control and do things. Now, that's our free will. So we all have free will, but this area over which we exercise our free will is varying depending on our past karma. So for example, we get angry, we might just yell at someone. But say the president of America gets angry, the president might send a nuclear bomb on some country and kill thousands, even millions. So based on one's present position, which one has acquired by one's past karma, one can have smaller or greater degrees of influence in the world. Now, while we have this circle of influence, in Sanskrit, the word used for this is kshetra. Now, what we do in our kshetra depends on our free will. And our free will is influenced also by how we have acted in the past. So if someone has repeatedly done bad things, then those bad impressions get stored in their consciousness as evil. So evil is not like a diabolical entity like Satan or Shaitan that is imagined in Christianity and Islam. Evil is simply the accumulation of accumulated impressions coming from our past our past misdeeds. So those who are evil, normally if we hurt someone, we immediately apologize, we immediately try to make amends. But if we repeatedly hurt someone, then immediately after that we start saying, hey, this is the way it is. We don't even make amends for that. We don't even feel bad about it. So there are evil people, they hurt others, and not only that, do they not feel bad in hurting others, but they sometimes get a sadistic joy in hurting others. Now, when that happens, you have to see that. So there is God's will, there is free will, and there is evil. So when people abusing their free will under the influence of evil do something terrible to us, that is not God doing it. That is not God doing it. That is that person doing it, being influenced by the evil within them. So if we start seeing God as the cause of all our suffering, it may become very difficult for us to surrender to Him. So now we may question, okay, but then why is God allowing this? Because that is a question which is very difficult to understand. Because we don't know what kind of karma we have done. We don't know what kind of things we need to go through. But what we can see is that whatever we go through, it is Krishna also goes through with us. Krishna is always there in our hearts. So now, when we see what did Draupadi do? When Dushyasana was disrobing her, she didn't, okay, it is Dushyasana's evil which is making her do it. So she turned toward Krishna and she absorbed herself in Krishna. So now, when she absorbed herself in Krishna, it was like calling out to Krishna, and Krishna became the shield by which whatever humiliating, dehumanizing thing was happening to her, she was not conscious. She did not let her consciousness stay over there. And then Krishna came, and Krishna also became the cure. And that situation was mitigated by providing her unlimited sari. In the case of Parikshit Maharaj, if we consider what happened. So Parikshit Maharaj got that curse, and then when Shukdev Goswami came, all the sages came, Parikshit Maharaj says, he doesn't tell them, oh, how unfortunate I am that for a small mistake I was given such a big punishment. He says, how fortunate I am that at the time of death all of you have come here. So rather than blaming why this happened, okay, this has happened. Now, what is the shield from it? What is the cure for it? And he saw that it's Krishna who is blessing him by sending all these sages. It is Krishna who is blessing him by sending Shukdev Goswami. It is Krishna who is blessing him by manifesting as a Krishna Katha coming through Shukdev Goswami's eyes into his heart. And in that case, there was no protection at the material level, but there was protection at the spiritual level. So now we could say Parikshit Maharaj also saw that actually this curse is also coming from Krishna. We could say it that way, but the important thing over here is that he focused not on that the curse has come from Krishna, not on where it has come from, he focused on where it is taking me. So now sometimes seeing our suffering as coming from Krishna, if it helps us say, okay, I had done something wrong and I need to rectify it, that is good. But sometimes if we don't see what wrong have I done, why is this coming, then we understand that sometimes in this world, evil just exists. Evil can be in the same, and sometimes just natural calamities cause wreckage of our lives. Sometimes human misdeeds cause the wreckage in our life. But whatever it is, why these happen, it's very difficult to know. But beyond all these, Krishna is always there to help us. So the protection of Krishna that the Bhagavatam demonstrates is the protection primarily at the level of consciousness. That he was always, his consciousness was protected. He did not become resentful. He did not become hopeless. He did not become suicidal. He just took shelter of Krishna. So all this is not to say that all of us, when we have danger, that's all we need to do. Now, for all of us, it's not that our material situation will always stay the way it is. We can make efforts and we should make efforts to rectify it. But we also needn't reduce Krishna's protection just to the rectification of our material situation. Something is wrong. And if Krishna can fix it, if Krishna fixes it, then my situation is rectified. But it's not necessarily like that. Krishna can help in many different ways. Recently, I was at the Chicago airport and I was waiting for the devotee who was going to pick me up. And I was talking on phone, and there was one more devotee with me who was looking after my bags. I had a check-in bag and a laptop bag. So I was talking on the phone, and then I looked back when the devotee, it was 2-3 minutes. I looked down, and it was 2-3 minutes. My laptop bag was stolen. And the devotee was with me. I thought he was looking at the bags, but he thought he was holding the check-in bag, and he said he didn't notice also that I had a laptop bag. So, and I never keep my passport in my laptop bag. I always keep it in my pocket, especially when I'm traveling. But on that day, I had kept it in my passport, in my laptop bag. But the passport was also lost. The laptop bag was also lost. And it's just not even more than 3 minutes. And so it was completely disorienting. What to do, how to move forward now. So, of course, I was praying that maybe somehow the bag will be found. At least if the passport is found, then I won't have the issues. But you know, we tried our best. We registered a police complaint. We searched. We did what we could. We couldn't find. But then I found that I realized once that avenue didn't work, okay, what is the avenue now? Now, okay, I have to arrange for another laptop. I have to arrange a passport. Now, I'm traveling constantly, and I can't travel internally without a passport. So then I found, as somehow I gave up that resentment about why the passport was lost, and I stopped being resentful and tried to become a little resourceful. Now what can I do? How can I get a passport? And then so many devotees from so many different places helped me. We got some contacts. Normally it takes 3 to 5 working days to get a Tatkal passport also. But devotees used their contacts from various places. We called the Consul General of New York and the Consul General of Chicago. And through it all, within 2 days, I got my passport. So sometimes, now of course, it was my mistake in some ways that the laptop bag was lost. But the point is that sometimes some material situations cannot be rectified. And if we think that Krishna's help is going to come, has to come in terms of the rectification of that material situation, then we may be looking in the wrong direction. But then I was thinking that if something like this had happened to me and I had just been alone, maybe if I had not been a practicing sadhaka, and if I had been alone, maybe on some job, work or something like that, and I would probably not have had such a big support of a community. So we need to be open to how Krishna's help may come upon us. In Srila Prabhupada's life, so I was thinking at that time that Prabhupada came to America, and the place where he was staying, apparently the janitor of that place, he stole Prabhupada's dictaphone and typewriter. And that was the only possession Prabhupada had. And at least I had a whole community of devotees across various cities who could help. The Prabhupada had no associates over there. There were very, very few devotees. There were practically no devotees, only a few well-wishers. And probably as important as my laptop was for me, Prabhupada's dictaphone and Prabhupada's typewriter was that important. Both of them were essential for his service. And Krishna's protection, how did it come to Prabhupada? At that time it came, Swamiji, this is not a good place for you to stay. You come and stay in another place. Another place, it was not necessarily any safer, but at that place, he was more accessible to the kind of people who would want to listen to him. And that's how, what was a disaster for Srila Prabhupada, which Prabhupada writes in his diary that in one of his entries that he, after that he felt, maybe I should just leave America and go back to India. But Prabhupada did not get discouraged. So Krishna's protection came in the form that through that he moved. So Prabhupada was earlier living in a high rise kind of place where that yoga teacher Dr. Mishra was teaching wealthy clients, and from there Prabhupada moved to like a little lower level place where. But still, where the wealthy people were not coming, but that was not, it was still not the place where the hippies would feel comfortable coming. So it was a place which seemed safe, but was not safe. So Prabhupada was not getting anybody practically coming over there. But because of that robbery, Prabhupada moved from that place to another place. And there, that's how his preaching expanded. So everything that happens may not be good, but everything that happens can be for good. That means what is sometimes bad things happen and they're bad. We don't have to imagine that they are good. But sometimes from that bad, something good can emerge. So, Rakshishiti iti vishvaso goptrutve varanam datha. That means that Krishna is my protector means that yes, Krishna will protect me, but how he will protect me, that I cannot impose terms and conditions on Krishna. So that protection cannot be tied to a particular expectation. That protection has to come with submission. It's like we say, beggars are not choosers. So protection has to come with submission. Krishna, what do you want me to do? How can I serve you in this situation? And if we have that attitude and we see what doors Krishna opens for us and we walk through those doors, then we will find that Krishna will, even if we are in a very dark place, Krishna will take us to a brighter place. For me, I don't know what brighter place the loss of the laptop and loss of the computer is going to take me. But at least one thing happened for me is that I developed so much appreciation for the association of devotees and also for the importance of devotees not just focusing on converting and preaching people, but also connecting with people who are influential. So some people walk through the doors we open so that they come to Krishna. And some people open the doors for us so that we can take Krishna to different places. Even those people don't come to Krishna. So we need to connect with people at whatever level they are comfortable. So at least that's one good that has come. But let's see. So if we are to be surrendered, surrender also means surrender of our expectations. Instead, we replace the expectation with submission. Krishna, whatever you want, I accept it. As Jesus said, let thy will be done. Let thy will be done, O Lord. So that is actually submission to Krishna, and that is surrender. Now, surrender has another aspect to it, which I'll talk in tomorrow's class. That is what Arjuna says at the end of the Bhagavad-Gita, that I will do your will. So that aspect of what we are meant to do as a part of surrender, what conception we have of ourselves and how we act, that I'll talk in tomorrow's session. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. I spoke on the theme of the six limbs of surrender, understanding how to see Krishna, how Krishna is our protector, how to have the faith that Krishna is our protector and that Krishna is our maintainer. So protection basically means that there are occasional big dangers, like say our home security or our police or our army protects us. And maintainer is the arrangement by which our life normally goes on. So for understanding how Krishna is our protector, I talked elaborately about causality and how things happen in the world. So when anything bad happens, is it Krishna doing everything? So Krishna is the ultimate cause of all causes, but he is not the immediate, he's the sanctioning cause, not the intending cause. So when things happen in the world, there is there is God's will, there is free will, and there is evil. So God is not that God is a supervisor. Supervisor means he oversees, not that he himself does everything. So free will is what every one of us has been given, and based on the kind of karma we have done in the past, the sphere over which the free will we can exercise varies from person to person. And if somebody abuses their free will to do evil, then what they are doing is not God's doing. It is what they are doing in, not because of God, but in spite of God. So basically, how do we, when we are going through distress, we basically may divide the world into me and the rest of reality. And if the rest of reality is causing distress to us, then how can we pray to the rest of the reality itself if we consider Krishna as non-different from the rest of reality? So in one sense, he's non-different, but in one sense, he's different. So how in that rest of reality, there is free will, there is evil, and there is ultimately God and his will. That's the differentiation we did. So sometimes we need to separate the two so that we don't see God as the cause of our suffering, but the free will and evil is the cause of our suffering. And God is the shield or the cure for the suffering. Sometimes we may see God as the cause of our suffering and the cure for our suffering. Just like a surgeon causes pain to cure pain. So Bharat Maharaj had to go through two lives as a deer and then as a Brahmana because of his mistake. And he was given the memory by which he understood why he was going through it. But we don't hear anything about Parikshit Maharaj being given the memory like that. And it is a minor mistake and a severe punishment. So if we can't see, if trying to look at God as the cause of our suffering makes us just frustrated, bewildered, and disheartened, then better just see that the cause of suffering in this world is inconceivable. The working of karma is so complex as to give even complex thinkers a complex. So therefore, just put aside, we don't know why this happens, but what can I do now? So if we turn toward Krishna as a shield from our suffering, okay, the suffering is there, but even while it is there, Krishna will give me the strength to tolerate it. And sometimes Krishna will be the cure for our suffering. The suffering will go away. So in the case of Draupadi, there was protection that manifested at the material level also. So Krishna acted as the cure for her suffering over there. Of course, the shield also, because she became absorbed in remembering Krishna and she was not aware of her humiliation. But it was more of a cure because the humiliation didn't actually happen. She could not be disrobed. That's why sometimes the incident we call as the disrobing of Draupadi, it is actually the attempted disrobing. She was not disrobed. But in the case of Parikshit, initially he was protected in the mother's womb, but at time of death he was not protected. Or was he? He was at the spiritual level. So Krishna was not a cure for the suffering at the material level, but he was a shield from the suffering. So Parikshit Maharaj was not resentment or fear or agony. He was absorbed in Krishna. Krishna's protection came for his consciousness. And that is the protection that we always will get if we turn toward Krishna. So surrender means ultimately surrender of our expectation also of how Krishna will protect us. And I talked about a laptop theft and how Krishna's help came not in the recovery of the laptop, but in the recovery of the passport of the laptop, but in the replacement of that. And the assistance, the resources that helped me do that. For Prabhupada, the loss of his dictaphone and his typewriter, the protection did not come in terms of regaining those specifically, but in redirecting him to a place that was more receptive for his outreach. So when we have that openness toward Krishna, we surrender by saying, Krishna, I will do your will. And then we replace expectation by submission. Then we will find that no matter how dark a place we may be in, Krishna, it's not that Krishna is sending us through the dark place. Krishna is going with us to the dark place and he will lead us to a brighter place. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So are there any questions? I'm just calling on phone now. Okay, you can speak. If anybody has questions, I'm also calling here. Hare Krishna, Mataji. Yes, can you ask? Hare Krishna. Okay. Who is the devotee? The devotee is the victim. Okay. So if a devotee is victimized by someone, now is it the devotee getting the reaction for their own past life karma, or is it the victimizer acting under the influence of evil and doing it? And what is Krishna's role in this? It's ultimately very difficult to know all this. As devotees, we need to focus on seeing how best we can serve Krishna in the situation we are in. Sometimes we counter the situation. Now, ultimately, the focus should be on our dharma in this life, not on our karma from the previous life. I repeat, our focus should be on our dharma in this life. That means, how best can I continue my service? My service may be my direct devotional service, it might be my family responsibilities, it might be my professional obligations. But we are meant to be able to do that as well as is possible. And do what it takes to get the place, to get the space to do that. Now, say for example, if somebody has a very bad boss, maybe exploitative, abusive, manipulative, whatever. Now, should a devotee who is working under such a boss see that, oh, this boss is there because of my past karma? Well, maybe, but if the working under that boss is just making our life so miserable that we can't chant, that we can't focus on chanting, we can't practice bhakti, then it's not that a devotee has to stay on in that job and think that by doing this job, I'll be exhausting my bad karma. That would be foolish. We don't have to unnecessarily stay in abusive situations as if that's the way to exhaust our past karma. Because we also have a responsibility to do our dharma. And I'll talk you more about this tomorrow in the session. But the point is, if we can get some other job where the situations are better, then we should do that. Of course, we need to compare. The mind always makes our suffering seems to be the worst. And we need to have some, maybe some friends, well-wishers who can actually help us objectively compare. Now, am I making too big an issue out of this? Or is it really a big issue? And we get a more objective picture. Based on that, we can take some action. So now, if somehow that is the only job we have and there's not much possibility, at least in the immediate future, of getting another job, then if you have to stay there, then we stay there and see, okay, this is what I have to go through because of my karma. But let me try to focus on my dharma. And let me try to shield myself from the situation as much as I can. So rather than worrying about whether it's my karma or this person's evil, we focus on our own dharma. Now, if we have a facility to maybe report to somebody higher in the office, and we may want to try that. So these are practical things which we shouldn't be blind to philosophy, philosophical perspective of them. But the philosophical perspective shouldn't blind us to the practical reality also. I'll have to explain this more in detail in tomorrow's class, but I'll give one example and conclude this. And when the devotees in London performed a Rath Yatra, they wanted to do a bigger Rath Yatra than what had been done in America. And thus they got a huge cart with a huge tower on top of it. But somehow they kept the wheels of the same size. And then it was a much publicized event, but the Rath cart went for maybe a few meters, and it just crumbled, the wheels crumbled. It was a disaster, a public relations fiasco. And the devotees were disheartened, and they wrote to Prabhupada that Prabhupada did this Ratha cart collapse because of our poor devotion. And Prabhupada said, it was not your poor devotion, it was your poor engineering. So poor engineering means that when you can find a practical cause and a practical solution at an immediate level, there is no need to escalate that to Krishna and think, okay, maybe Krishna is displeased with our devotion, that's why Krishna let this happen. No. So similarly, if there is a practical problem and it can be solved practically, there is no need to escalate it to the practical past life karma level also. But sometimes the practical problem doesn't seem to have any practical cause and doesn't seem to have any practical solution. Then what do? We accept it as something based on our past karma, and then we pray to Krishna that he give us the strength to tolerate it, to live with it. So for example, if we get some disease and doctors are not able to diagnose it, doctors are not able to cure it, and we have to live with the disease, then we may say, okay, I did not do anything by which I would have got infected or got this disease, but somehow I got it and it's not getting cured. So let me do the best I can. So sometimes we working for our service to Krishna, for our dharma, we may try to counter the situation and do what it takes to practically do that. But sometimes if it's not possible to counter, then we may accept that situation and seek to surrender to Krishna in that situation. So basically, don't get too caught in thinking what is whose karma. Focus on what is our dharma and how we can best do that, and how we can create the space for us to be able to do our dharma. Does that answer your question? If you have any follow-up questions, we can discuss tomorrow. Tomorrow, I'll keep my class a little shorter, and we can have more time for question answers. Is that okay? Thank you very much. If any of you have questions, if you want to send them by WhatsApp or something like that to the conference leaders, I can take those questions in the last session, in case you have for this or any of the previous sessions also. So tomorrow I'll speak for about half an hour, and we can have a half an hour question answers. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavati Jai. Jai. Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Ki Cha Tai Gaurmana. Thank you. Ready?